This is Success Stories, a program of the Sorrell College of Business at Troy University. I'm Alan Mendenhall, Associate Dean of the Sorrell College of Business at Troy University and Executive Director of the Manuel H. Johnson Center for Political Economy. Success Stories is a program that highlights the lives and careers of people who have accomplished great things. And my guest today is Professor William A. Jacobson, who is a clinical professor of law and director of Securities Law Clinic at Cornell Law School. He's also the founder of the Legal Insurrection website and the founder and president of the Legal Insurrection Foundation. Bill, it's great to have you with me.
It is great to be here. Thank you.
Well, let's start, first of all, with Legal Insurrection, the website, and the foundation. You are a law professor. How did you develop this as a side gig that may or may not be your main gig right now?
Well, it was happenstance. So I joined Cornell Law School in 2007. Late in 2007. Prior to that, I'd been in private law practice. And later in 2008, during the presidential campaign in August, actually, I was having dinner with a former client, somebody I'd become very friendly with, had won a lot of money for him, but we never talked politics. And he asked me at dinner in late August of 2008, who are you voting for? And I said, well, I'm voting for John McCain and Sarah Palin. And we got into this big argument. And at the end of the argument, he said, you know, you haven't changed my mind, but I've never heard anybody explain your side as well as you do. You should start a blog. I had no idea what a blog was. I wasn't political. If you Googled me prior to late August, you would have just found I was on this bar committee. I won this case. I lost that case. I joined Cornell. And so I said, okay, let me look into this. And so I asked around, I looked into it, and I found Google Blogger, which was free and super simple to use. And I said, okay, maybe I'm gonna do this, I'll start writing. So we're now into September of 2008, the heart of the election cycle. And so I said, okay, now I need a name. What am I gonna call it? And I did like word association. And the name, the word insurrection, in 2008 came to mind. I was so frustrated with the media bias that I was witnessing in favor of Obama and against McCain and particularly against Sarah Palin. I said, that's how I'm feeling. I'm so fed up. I'm so frustrated. And I looked up the word insurrection, and by definition, it's illegal. Thought, well, you know, I started this law professor job not that long ago. Maybe it's not great to have a blog that's basically called illegal. And so I said, let me call it legal insurrection, which is actually a contradiction in terms. There is no such thing as a legal insurrection. That's how I got the name. And I went and I, you know, used their basic template and I started posting in October of 2008. And that's how the website came into being.
And then so you started generating a lot of views and getting a lot of attention, and you were asked to start coming on podcasts or television shows, radio programs. I don't know if podcasts were quite yet a thing.
Yeah, not a thing yet.
Yeah, but you got a lot of attention through that. What happened in those intervening years, let's say between, you know, 2011 and 2018, I believe, is when you started the foundation, correct?
Yeah.
What happened in those years that led to the creation of the foundation?
Sure. So my first post was October 12th of 2008, I remember it well, and you're right, things for whatever the reason took off. I was a solo blogger back in the day when blogs were a big thing, and that before, I mean, Twitter existed, but not like it does now. Social media existed, but not like it does now. And my stuff began to get noticed. By the end of October of 2008, a lot of complaints to the law school. How could they possibly have somebody like me on the faculty? And so for several years that kept up the kind of harassment attempts to get me fired. And then I realized being solo it was just too much because, as we say, the beast must be fed. When you have a website, you need fresh content. And it was just too much for me to do alone. So I was solo for 2 years. Then I brought on a second blogger who was a Cornell undergrad student I met because I was the faculty advisor to the Cornell Republicans. I'm the faculty advisor to every right of center group on campus because there's nobody else. I left Google Blogger around 2011-ish, around there, and we created our own website, custom designed website, began to add people to the website. Sometime, I think 2014, we actually began to pay people because we were all volunteer, including me. I've always been volunteer. We began to pay people just because we needed the consistency. When you have a volunteer organization, it's like everybody wants to do something this week, and next week they're all on vacation. It's like herding cats. So over time, we became a more business-like, more professional, if you want to call it that, website. Traffic continued to grow. I did a lot of media appearances. We were quoted on all of the major conservative outlets. Rush Limbaugh used to love to read our stuff, and that was always good because I know I'd get all these text messages from people. Oh, Rush just read your post or something like that. And at a certain point in time, I realized we didn't have the resources that we needed to do the sort of investigations we do. And that's really what set us apart from the rest of the blogosphere. We weren't just, you know, posting 300 word, you know, hot item of the day. We would do investigations that sometimes would last years. So we did a lot on the anti-Israel movement. We did a lot on the anti-free speech movement on campuses. We were covering that long before cancel culture was the term of the day. And we also covered politics. We can't do as much now as we used to because we're now a tax-exempt entity. But back in 2011, 12, 13, 14, we did so much research on Elizabeth Warren that we actually ended up creating a separate website about all our research, ElizabethWarrenWiki.org. Looks like Wikipedia, but it's not. So we did all these, and that project with her lasted several years. So that's what we do. We find these things and we follow them through, sometimes for 5, 6, 7 years. And that's what nobody else does. And then at a certain point in time, just from a business model perspective, digital media is really tough. You're either really big, okay, or you struggle. And there was just no way. Now that we're paying people, we're now in 2014, 15, 16, we could generate from ad revenue what we needed and what we felt we wanted to do. So we created Legal Insurrection Foundation, which is a Rhode Island, because I split the year between Rhode Island and Ithaca, tax-exempt organization. We filed for our IRS approval. We obtained that in 2018. And we formally launched Legal Insurrection Foundation on March 1 of 2019.
And do you ever take cases? Do you ever blend your work as a lawyer with your work with Legal Insurrection? Do you ever do litigation?
Yeah, not previously. We just launched a project in the end of February of this year, called the Equal Protection Project, which is equalprotect.org, where we will litigate, but that's something new for us. Prior to that, we were just shining a spotlight on things. We had a very long history of finding things that nobody else was writing about, following through on them, and then being able to push them out into broader media. So they would become sometimes national stories, and people may not realize they started with us, but because since 2008, I'd been dealing with conservative media, by 2018, 19, et cetera, all the people who now run big media operations, I knew them when they were solo bloggers too, or many of them. And so we have had those connections, and that's really what we began to do. But this is something new for us where we would get in and actually litigating. But prior to this year, we never did that. We just accomplished what we accomplished by shining a light and getting publicity about it.
I could see this new initiative growing in the way the blog grew, in the sense that you had to hire new writers, and this might require that you hire other attorneys because you might not be able to do it all on your own and that sort of thing. So it will be interesting to see how that plays out. What are some examples of stories that you worked on at the blog that went national in scope?
Well, I think Elizabeth Warren's the perfect example. We did not find her Cherokee deception, okay? Boston Herald, full credit to them, in April of 2012, disclosed that she had been named by Harvard in a publication a decade earlier as the first Native American tenured professor at Harvard Law School. But we took it and we ran with it. And we worked with Cherokee genealogists who were doing the basic research, and we continued to push that throughout the 2012 campaign. And the Cherokee findings, genealogist findings, we tracked her history back to the early 1800s, her family lines. There's no Native American ancestry there that can be found. We tracked a lot of her family lore stories, and with the help of the Cherokee genealogists, we found, for example, her parents' engagement announcement in the local paper in 1930 in rural Oklahoma, which was inconsistent with what she was saying on the campaign trail, which is that one of the family lore stories that led her to be convinced she's Native American is that her parents had to elope because her father's family would not accept her mother's family because they were Native American. That's very inconsistent with an engagement announcement in the local newspaper congratulating these two fine young people from town on their engagement. Does it disprove her 100%? Well, no, because it's a long time ago, but it's certainly inconsistent. We found other inconsistencies. We tracked down other issues in her career. For example, she represented herself as having representing the little people, the little guys against the big bad corporations. That was her MO. Well, we actually dug into her cases, and the truth is just the opposite. She routinely represented large corporations against smaller individuals or against on issues that impacted smaller individuals. So for example, she claimed that she helped rescue a rural Louisiana electric cooperative. In fact, she did just the opposite. She was representing a large energy company trying to put it out of business so they could purchase the main energy plant, electricity generating plant. We got affidavits from the lawyers involved, and we went public with this, that no, she was actually trying to shut it down. And so we did this. We found out that she was not licensed to practice law in Massachusetts at a time that she was representing to the Texas bar, which is where she has her bar registration, that her office at Harvard was her office for the practice of law. Well, if you're going to maintain an office for the practice of law in a state, you have to be licensed in that state. She represented to courts that her Harvard office was her law office, but she wasn't registered in Massachusetts. And so that almost killed her campaign. That was something where for the first time we ran into the buzzsaw of a very well-funded political campaign. They managed to kill that story.
Wow.
But it came very close to putting her out of business. So I think Elizabeth Warren is probably the primary example. We kept, and there were several other issues that we then put that on ElizabethWarrenWiki.org and maintained it and updated it for about 7 years. And then in 2020, the people who fell in love with that website were Bernie Sanders supporters who opposed Warren in the primaries, and we have everything documented there. For the record, the most exhaustive takedown of her Cherokee deception anywhere. And so that's just a good example of what we did. And that was a 7-year effort. And we did it, you know, it doesn't even have advertising on it, but it's out there as a resource for people. So that's probably the best example. But we've had others, Gibson's Bakery versus Oberlin College. That was the first project of the Legal Insurrection Foundation. Now, I'd been covering that story since 2016. When the protest took place. So for those who don't know, Gibson's Bakery was a fifth generation bakery right near the Oberlin campus. And the day after the 2016 election, the owners of the store, the Gibsons, stopped a black Oberlin College student who was shoplifting. And they stopped him, and a scuffle ensued, and the police were called. He was, in fact, shoplifting, okay? He later pleaded guilty to some related charge. But the university and the students erupted that this was racial profiling. And there were huge protests outside the bakery. The college ended up dropping them because they used to provide baked goods to the dining hall. And we covered that since 2016. We covered the lawsuit that ensued over it, the defamation lawsuit. Nobody else was really covering this. And we kept at it. And then in 2019, when it was getting set to go to trial, we were the only national outlet to have somebody in the courtroom. We hired a freelance reporter in Ohio to sit in on the trial and report on our website every night about what was happening in the trial. Nobody else was paying attention to it, but I spotted it as having huge potential, that the defense of the university, the college, to the lawsuit was so ridiculous and so aggressive and so nasty. I said, this could really blow up on them. So we had somebody in there, and every night he would report. What we thought would be a 2 or 3 week trial turned into a 6 or 7 week trial. And we built a following on the website, people coming in, because it wasn't live streamed. And when the $11 million compensatory verdict for defamation came down against Oberlin College, everybody turned to us. And I did a lot of TV appearances. I had an op-ed in the Wall Street Journal. And that's a good example of where we got into something, we brought national attention to it, and then when the rest of the world started to pay attention, we were the go-to people. And so that's just another example.
Well, we sit here in Montgomery, Alabama, home, or at least a home, to the civil rights movement, and we're actually in a studio above the Rosa Parks Museum. Your work at the Equal Protection Project could be described, could it not, as contesting what might be a corruption or even a hijacking of the civil rights movement. Is that a fair characterization?
I think that is. I mean, we are big supporters of the traditional American civil rights movement, which is that every individual is entitled to be treated with the equal protection of the law and have the full opportunity to achieve the American dream without regard to skin color, race, ethnicity, etc. And that's the highest ideal, and that's what we support. Unfortunately, over the past several years, we've noticed that being corrupted by the concept that racial justice means essentially racial retribution. It means discriminating against people on the basis of their race to achieve what they call equity, some balancing of races, balancing of ethnicities, and it's a group identity focus. So you measure justice in that ideology based on how groups perform as opposed to how individuals are treated. And so that has resulted, and we've seen many examples, in discrimination against white people, Asians, others, in order to achieve some desired racial mix. And we're against that. I mean, we're against, so our, at the Equal Protection Project, which we launched in February of this year, our mission statement is that we are for fair treatment and equal treatment of everybody without regard to race, and that there is no good form of racism, and that the answer to racism never is more racism. That's pushing us backward. It's a very regressive sort of ideology. And we launched the project because as part of Legal Insurrection Foundation, we have followed the critical race movement. We have a website, criticalrace.org, devoted to documenting that. And we began to get tips and we began to get complaints there about open discrimination, not even hiding it. And one of them that we got was in Providence, Rhode Island, where we're based in Rhode Island. And the Providence School District, which is the largest in the state and which is a complete disaster, so bad that the state had to take it over, that they had a new teacher hiring incentive program where new teachers into the system to encourage them to come to Providence could get student loans forgiven, up to 25,000 of student loans, but it was only open to non-whites. And we got that tip and we looked into it, and obviously that is the sort of thing that we're objecting to, that you cannot discriminate against a prospective white teacher to achieve some sort of diversity quota system that you're looking for. And so we brought a lot of attention to that. We filed a civil rights complaint with the U.S. Department of Education because Providence receives tens of millions of dollars a year in federal education assistance. The education department took the view that this was more of an employment practice problem rather than an education, so they made a formal referral to the EEOC. And the EEOC is looking into it. We know they've assigned an investigator. We know they are processing it, and they seem to be taking it seriously. So that's a good example of where we're looking at it, and we said, this is not enough for us just to shine a light on it. We need to take action. Providence had other problems. They were, the school system, a public school system, was promoting and sponsoring and putting on segregated teacher meetups off school grounds, so they would rent a venue, and it was only open to non-white teachers. And again, we said, this is not something we should just spotlight. So what we did there was we wrote to the venue where it was being held. And we wrote to them and said, you probably don't realize this, okay? And we're not really blaming you. But the event that Providence is holding at your facility is actually a segregated event. It's unlawful. They can't do that. And you have potential legal liability because you're subject to the Rhode Island public accommodations law, which for things that are public accommodations, think of hotels, event forums, movie theaters, anything that's generally open to the public, you have the same non-discrimination requirements as anybody else. And so we wrote to them and we pointed this out, and all of a sudden the next day the event's not being held at that venue. I would have loved to be a fly on the wall when the event venue said, oh my God, what are we doing here? Because as far as they knew, they're just renting out space to Providence School District. And then Providence announced in reaction to publicity about it that they're no longer going to do that. The wording on the form was mistaken, okay? It wasn't, okay? And we have other issues in Providence we'll be dealing with. But that led us to say, we need to do more than just shine a light, because we're getting all these tips about, frankly, open discrimination. I mean, it's not just a nod and a wink. It's actual guidelines at public entities that are discriminatory that we said we're going to launch the Equal Protection Project, and we're going to start to challenge these. And we've done several challenges in the 3 months that we've been in existence.
Well, talk a little bit about your teaching, and what you teach at Cornell, and how you instruct students, and what that part of your career involves.
Yeah, has nothing to do with what I do at the website. People say, well, there's a disconnect here. Well, not really. I mean, people are entitled to have multiple interests. I actually teach investment law, right, related to the segment of securities law that I focus on are what I would call retail securities. It's brokerage firms, broker-dealers, stock brokerage firms, whatever you want to call them, and where investors, smaller investors, we don't take big cases, have a problem with a stockbroker and or a stock brokerage firm, and we pursue those claims for them, or we evaluate them. We do a lot of other things. We do public presentations. We do briefs, amicus briefs in cases. We've done several of those. So we do a lot of different things, but it's focused on the investment aspects of individual investors and the problems they have.
And was that the area of law you practiced in before you were a professor?
Yes, I am definitely an anomaly because I was a plaintiff's contingency fee securities lawyer before joining Cornell, and not necessarily aligned with my political views. You don't expect that, but I consider them completely consistent, which is a focus on the rights of the individual and treating individuals being treated fairly. It doesn't matter whether it's a stock brokerage firm or an insurance company or a car dealer or anything else, that, you know, we believe in individual rights. And so I consider it consistent, but it's not what you expect. Most people in my practice area were extremely liberal, extremely left-leaning. And so, yeah, it's a strange thing to people, but it's just the way I've got these two aspects of my life which sometimes collide, but not frequently. And that's what I am, and that's how I'm. But most people know me through legal insurrection.
Yeah, well, it may not be as strange in our current era with the rise of ESG, and you've got capital markets and securities being bound up in politics in ways that weren't possible maybe 2 decades ago. So that's an interesting development. Where did you practice when you practiced? Like, where were you?
Well, I was originally in New York City. Okay. So out of law school, I graduated in 1984, moved. I'm from the New York City area originally. Actually moved back to the town I grew up in. My kids went to the elementary school that I went to. And then at a certain point in time, I just couldn't take the commuting anymore. We lived just outside the city in what was considered a good commute. Okay, but it was tough. And my father had done it his whole life, and I swore I would never do that. I'm already 9 years into that. And I just had one of those miserable New York City commuter experiences where it was, a million degrees on the subway platform. The Long Island Railroad was jam-packed so you couldn't even sit down. Sweating profusely in a suit and tie. And I got home and I said to my wife, I said, this is going to kill me. Okay, this is literally going to kill me. She said, let's get out of here. We had kids who were 3, 5, and 7 at the time. We said, if we don't move now, we're never going to move. Because once they're into middle school and high school, it's very tough to pull kids, okay? And we said, let's get out of here. And then we decided, well, where are we going to go? And we found Providence, Rhode Island, which is actually a kind of nice city. We wanted to stay in the New England, Northeast area. We didn't want to go to Boston, another big city, same problems. And so, like the Beverly Hillbillies, we loaded up the truck and we moved to Providence, Rhode Island. We sold our house on Long Island. I had no job lined up in Providence. I had enough carryover work from the firm I was working at that I knew I would be busy for 6+ months because they needed me to continue to work on some cases because I was the one who knew everything about them. And we just moved and things worked out. I then switched sides. I used to do defense work, so I used to defend stock brokerage firms, and then I flipped sides and became a plaintiff's lawyer and practiced in Providence, Rhode Island until the end, until 2006.
Wow. Well, Bill, I will say I appreciate your work in restoring the sort of historical sense of the laws that developed over time to protect individual rights and individual liberties and to judge people on the basis of their actions from which you can infer intent, but not on the basis of immutable characteristics right. like race, which people just can't help. You don't discriminate against people on the basis of things that they can't help, the way they're born. And so I appreciate your work in that area, and it has been really nice to have you as a guest on the show. Folks, that was Professor William A. Jacobson of Cornell Law School. He's also the founder and president of Legal Insurrection Foundation. And this has been an episode of Success Stories. I'm Alan Mendenhall, signing off. Thanks for watching.